So, with the advent of Internet of Things, everything like controlling your TV, coffee makers, has become a child's play. But are we really making our life simpler, or are we digging ourselves into an ocean that is getting deeper and deeper as our data is being tracked by a number of websites? So, morning everyone, my name is Dipesh Monga. I'm contributing as a tech speaker at Mozilla. I'm currently working as a research associate at Indian Institute of Technology in our area, and where I work on the development of IoT-based system on chips, and I love tinkering with emerging technologies. So yeah, so I guess most of you might be having a clear definition of IoT. So these are some definitions that are being currently given by the Wikipedia and Oxford. And this is my preferred definition: the interface between the physical and digital world that allows one information to collect from and control everything objects. But is IoT like giving a particular name, Internet of Things, is really necessary? Because it has been around us from quite a few years. Like for example, say our phone. A mobile phone has a number of sensors and other hardware stuff going on. There's a proximity sensor, battery level monitor and everything. And it's all connected to the Wi-Fi, to the good cloud, the internet. And now, I guess we can break Internet of Things into parts like the hardware. These tiny bits and pieces like this device, it's an ultrasonic sensor. I can fit this in a door and it can start giving me information about if the door is open and closed. So I guess everyone is quite familiar with these terms and the data, everything. The hardware talks in the form of data. It's the universal language for everything, the data. And the software is what interprets the data and it gives to the user and offers the connectivity. So these are the few common hardware software parts and connectivity. We have a number of sensors, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi. And I'm also currently working on a new technology called light fidelity, which is the transfer of data using light. But the most important question is okay, if I have a thermostat that is connected to internet and it's giving me information that when I'm here, so in my home, and it gives that, okay, you have reached your home and let me turn on the thermostat. But it better not share this information with anyone. So is our Internet of Things really secure? We are making our lives really, we are trying to make our life simpler by connecting each and everything to internet. But there are a lot of dangers of uploading our physical lives that I'm going to talk about and cover in this session. So what if your data being tracked is accessible to anyone and he gets information like this? I don't want anyone to get these information. Yeah. So let's talk about the vulnerabilities in IoT ecosystem for all the points that we have broken. For the hardware, if someone can get into an access into your hardware, so he can get a shell access. He can view. Config the review. He can edit the config file, and it can provide him the access. And if he tries to penetrate into the software, so these are like we don't know what while installation we don't care about what privileges the software asks before installation, and then the data. So the data to which the machine talks to, we can't understand that it is generally interpreted by the software. So what if I can access the data from some debug codes using devices that I'll be talking about later on? And what if it's easily decrypted and accessible to anyone? And the connectivity, the cloud, the place where all the data is going. So I don't have any ideas. Take an example of any simple device that you are using in your homes. There are quite common few IoT devices available. So is the data that is being sent to the cloud encrypted? It is being, is it being authenticated? And who is storing the data? Does the company or server that where the data is being stored, is it like accessible on, is it encrypted or so think of an example of if we are, since we are not secure, we are not secure on the net, our device is not secure, we don't care currently about our privacy, so if it's doing the thing, it's good. So if my coffee maker makes a coffee when I wake up, then it's good for me, that's it. So like in cigarettes, it comes with a warning that smoking is injurious to health. What if the scenario comes in, we don't care about our privacy, and then the manufacturer had to like give these warnings that okay, so when you are in your washroom, so an intruder might break in and you are giving your smart wallet the permission that attacker can access your house when you are in your washroom doing your business. So let's break the IoT attacks. According to priorities, so there are three types of attacks that are commonly seen. One is the physical attack, another one the local, and one third one is the remote. So what? So in physical, if an attacker or an exploiter can get into your hardware and access it, that is the least priority for an hacker who wants to get the information or your access to your habits, your daily schedules. So I'll be covering each section one by one. And then is the local, like if it gets into your network, and one small vulnerability can let the whole network down, and all the devices, all the things connected to the internet are easily accessible. And then is the most favorite for all attackers, is the remote access. So if you can get an access to your home via some from a remote location and control your light bulbs and TV and all the stuff. So I'll be covering first the physical part. So how an attacker or a person can target your devices and get into them. So there's this device very common, it's generally called a UART. So it has a one wire. It has four wires. So it is one for power supply, ground, and transmission and reception (VX and RX). So it's this device. So what you can do, I'll take an example later on. And this one is a chips that are embedded in your devices, hardware devices, that stores the information, the OS, the firmware, the bootloader, and stuff. So these are generally in all the devices are pretty much embedded there. So let's take an example of this internet control device. This is an Epson Artisan 700 or 800 model printer. And when you open the printer, there's some ports. You can easily access the TX and RX pins. So this, all the data can be about this layout and everything can be found on this website, even in the source. So when I connect this USB TTL device, and what it does, it shows a root access, gives a root access. I can reboot my printer or maybe show info, anything, or my favorite, run shell command. Any shell command I can run using the root access. So I guess then we can move on to, like, we have a LG smart refrigerator example. We are more into like making our life simpler. So we are not caring about currently the privacy and security issues relating to the hardware and stuff. So this refrigerator works on Android 2.3 and everything is controlled by using this hardware. So it can be exploited in two ways. It has a EMMC and a UART also. So when you connect your UART device, then it boots into root console and you can easily exploit the reference data. I'll show you a demo in the end, a video demo also. And then if we get into MMC, so MMC can be accessed by the, there are some resistors nearby. So like these are some resistors nearby in the MMC. You can see in the down. So it can be accessed by these MMC, and then you can install and stock Android and install some apps and everything in the smart refrigerator. And my favorite one is this SGM Orin at home. Basically, it is a device which is used for medical purposes. So what it does is it takes the information about your pacemakers and everything, medical equipment connected to your body, and it gives it to the SGM Orin. This website where the physicians are reviewing all the data that is being sent, and I can access this using my again UART device, and I can send the information, whatever information I want, to the doctor that yeah, so he is getting a heart attack and everything, and no one is like going to know that is that information being sent by me, or like it was an actual information. So yeah. And then number of devices, you can go on and on, that can be found on this website. So these are the way like you can get a physical access to these devices. And this is the website, you can find step-by-step instructions on how to explore the hardware. Yeah. So then the second thing is getting into local network. Probably these can be accessed. The local network can be, you want to access your neighbor's Wi-Fi and maybe turn on his, bother him and turn on his TV and switch on his light and everything. So it's not of much relevance, but a recent demo that we did in our college. So what we did that, we took a drone, we mounted a Raspberry Pi Zero on it with Kali Linux, and it was getting the information of packets. It was using the packets nearby, connected to the local network of the hostel, and we made a like a whole. It went to all the wings of all the blocks of the hostel, and we got all the sessions of the students and the what they were accessing. So these are the ways you can like get into local network. I'll also show you a demo in the video in the end, like how the local network can be accessed. And the most like after that is this device. You can easily create it's the tutorials given in the end. So it's basically, it looks like a charger, but it's not a charger. So there's obviously a charger circuit inside it, but it captures what you are typing in your wireless keyboard. So if you are like logging to Facebook or everything, I can access it. And it has a GPS device, this GPS small device. There's a SIM card inside it, and it sends what keys are being pressed to me. So this way, like if you want to give your friend this charger and like. So these are the ways you can access the local network and exploit the hardware. And the next is this getting remote access. It's just an example of how you can get a remote access. Have anyone heard about this Shoda? Okay, next. So this is a search engine for vulnerable IoT devices. It gives a list of all the devices that are like connected to it internet. And for example, let's take a demo of like, I want to search this Honeywell building network adapter, and I'll just simply type this in this browser, and I can define it by country or by geolocation, host name, and there's a number of filters available, and it gives the list of all the Honeywell network building adapters. So now next I just type the name of the adapter, and then search for the password. And yeah, there's a PDF available on Honeywell website. I read this PDF and what I find that there's okay. So then I go again back to student. I log in as root and I can remove the router and everything. So we are like, for the sake of our convenience, we are neglecting this part from a long time of the privacy of Internet of Things with neighbor devices. So it's really a big issue. And there are power meters available. You can search for power meters on this website, and it gives the maps also, very interactive maps of control systems on the internet. So, and these are some potential targets of this search engine. So you can maybe turn on and off a power plant or something like that using this. These are some images that you don't want anyone to see, your personal life that are being acquired. So yeah, it's currently a big issue, a big scenario that you want to consider thinking about again. So they can get access to our attackers can purchasing patterns, our access codes, our driving habits, maybe real-time location. So even your car has these number of computational systems, there's GPS, there's diagnostic device and locks and everything. And if one small part of it is exploited, the whole network, the interconnected network which is running this number of lines of code can be exploited easily. And what if your car is exploited and your gate smart lock decides to lock you out? Or in the future, maybe your toaster stops working and you have to buy a firewall or something like that to your toaster. So, yeah. So it's around us everywhere now. We are surrounded by even the toys also. This is an example of this Hello Barbie doll that came. It was a Wi-Fi controlled doll. So there's some group of hackers. What they did was they found a vulnerability in this and they got an access to the whole Wi-Fi network using this Barbie doll. So see, we are neglecting these small, even the toys can do such a vulnerable So then there are like insulin pumps also that are Wi-Fi enabled. That HMLing is a like that also, only that tracks the level of a glucose and injects the glucose according to your sugar level. So what if in future I get an access of this device and I can inject the amount of insulin that I want to and maybe kill anyone? So yeah, and there's all number of devices available, number of startups and everyone like focusing on these devices that are making our life simpler. But okay, so in future like they can deny to provide service or like that. So for now, I'll show you the demo of local adapt that I told you about using Tune. So this is a vulnerable mouse here. This was shown at a DEFCON 2015 and I go for my coffee and there this phone comes and it starts typing. So it's exploiting the wireless mouse. So next is this printer I told you about. You can like access, it's connected to this UART, the four pins, and you can type the commands and everything from the root as a root. This is the LG Smart TV. So it's currently booting with the Android. It has 2.3, and now when I install in the EMMC, I have installed two Android versions. This one is the one that comes in the refrigerator itself, and now like
these other functions, the English function. But if I launch my launcher, it's a stock and void running. You can install apps and I have a super user access and everything. This refrigerator. Like I have installed some apps also. Can run terminal in your in a smart refrigerator. Yeah, and then there's another device I told you about, the SGM module. So I can get this device into party mode and blink all the lights. Now I'll show you that demo of Shona, so in, like how you can access your cats and everything.
Are you going to hack Microsoft?
So this is the search engine, as it should say the search engine for security. Just need an account in this. It's very simple to use this the search engine. You need to type the name. You have to create an account. And now I have to type a precise name of company of webcams making it, maybe, or even I can just simply type webcam. I can filter it. It shows the list of webcams available. But my favorite one that is very easily accessible is the Ocam. Oh, there's a number of companies. So I'll just open this. So I'm going to need this. There's this device called ASP266, I guess the hardware device you can that might be knowing about it. So you can just write ASP266, it basically control all your, you can make your home automation using this small device. It's just for projects and stuff. So you can just type anything you want to, like that is that might be probably connected to the internet. It can be accessed. So now there's this number of devices and there's some relay board. Everything is there. So you can just keep on, so you can have an access to the relay control page, the chat control page, and the weather is on stuff. So yeah, that's okay. So yeah, that's it for the privacy and security concerns related to it. You can tweet us at using these hashtags if you have any questions.
So is this last thing that you did, is it actually legal?
Yeah, actually this project Shodan is legal. So these are basically what it does, it searches for the devices, the webcams that you haven't protected, that you haven't given passwords and everything. So it just shows the links and displays all those devices. We are basically getting an IP cam on your browser. So it's basically searching these webcams for you. Yeah, yes, you did. Any other questions? Okay. If you want to know more about the hardware and how is it done, you can like meet me after this event, and, or you can email me or tweet me. Thank you.
Thank you.